Hello everyone, welcome to this VTU eSikshana program for the subject climatology for BArch students, architecture students. I'm Kuladeep, I'm an architect taking up this session for the module 2 and module 3 of this subject climatology for third semester architecture students. So in this module 2, we are going to cover thermal comfort 2 as a topic. I'll explain the syllabus and we will discuss which part of the syllabus we are covering in this lecture. The first module has been taken by Professor Sanket, and I'm continuing that session. So there'll be a few points, few topics which we might repeat as a recap from the previous module. So this particular presentation talks about the thermal comfort part 2, because part 1 is in the part of module 1. So here we'll repeat a part of module 1 and then continue with module 2 with thermal comfort topic. So this is the overall outline of the syllabus for climatology. So we are at this point, module 2. So this is module 2. So this particular lecture and plus another one more lecture. So there we have two lectures covering under this topic. So this lecture is part A of module 2, topic 1, which is thermal comfort 2. And then the next lecture will also continue with the same topic, which is part B of the same thing. Then we'll continue with the SunPath diagram, SunPath understanding SunPath and the impact of usage of SunPath in different aspects of climatology. Then we'll talk about thermal performance, and that covers module 2. So my portion in the whole syllabus will be covering module 2 and module 3. I will discuss more in detail about module 2 and module 3, what we will cover in module 3 in the upcoming lectures. So let's start with this thermal comfort 2. And as I told earlier, so we are going to recap a few aspects, few topics which you have covered in module 1, especially the climatic elements which you would have discussed in module 1. And we will talk about the thermal comfort and the indices again. We'll try and repeat and understand how the elements are used to define the thermal comfort, and we'll see how the indices are being prepared, how we define a thermal comfort. So if you want to understand what is thermal comfort for me, what parameters are required to understand what is thermal comfort, we will try to see in this particular session and the upcoming lecture. So first two lectures we'll talk about thermal comfort. So let's get into the content. So in this presentation we are going to cover majorly the thermal comfort. Then we'll see adaptive thermal comfort model. What is adaptive thermal comfort model when we have thermal comfort? So we'll discuss that, and then what indices will define this thermal comfort. Then we'll see majorly what we need to understand is the relation between temperature and humidity and how it impacts the thermal comfort. So this is something that we are going to discuss in detail in this first two lectures of module 2. So what is thermal comfort? How do you define thermal comfort? So as defined by ASHRAE, which is American Society for Heating and Refrigeration Air Conditioning Engineers, which is a premium body which defines the parameters required for thermal comfort, especially for mechanical engineers who take care of the building's comfort through air conditioning systems. So we need to understand that architects play a major role in making a building very much climate responsive and meeting our thermal comfort. In olden days, when we don't have our air conditioning, when we don't have any mechanical systems, our buildings used to be designed so climatically responsive so that we can be well comfortable in those buildings without any of these mechanical systems. So we didn't have fans, we didn't have air conditioning systems, but still we used to be very comfortable through the building design itself, through the building systems itself, through the building itself. So building acts as a thermal barrier between your extreme temperatures outside, which might be very cold, which might be very hot, but you want yourself to be comfortable within the house that we make for ourselves. So here, as per ASHRAE, the thermal comfort is the condition of mind that expresses satisfaction. So ultimately, what is thermal comfort is nothing but when we feel comfortable. When we feel comfortable means we are expressing our satisfaction with the surrounding situation. So if it is too hot, we'll feel hot. So that's the feeling that we get. Sometimes what we feel might not be the same thing what others might feel. Sometimes I would be super feeling super hot, but my person who is sitting beside me might be feeling very cold. Sometimes they say to switch off the fan, and I might need the fan, but he might not need the fan. So it's a general condition of the mind that expresses satisfaction with the thermal environment and is assessed by subjective evaluation. The word subjective evaluation, here we need to understand that it is very subjective, and we cannot have one thermal comfort definition, one thermal comfort situation for the whole world, for all the places, for all climatic zones, for all different people, for all different activities. So there are different aspects that we need to understand how to define the thermal comfort, that we'll look into these aspects in the upcoming slides. So the task of the designer is to create the best possible indoor climate. So the best possible indoor climate is nothing but to meet the thermally comfortable indoor climate. As Toyota says, I think architecture as a piece of clothing to wrap around human beings. So for example, if we are going to Ooty or Kashmir, we will definitely wear our clothing in such a way that we feel ourselves comfortable in the cold weather. So in the same way, the way we change our clothing based on the weather conditions is the same way the architecture is also a kind of clothing for the indoor environment that we are going to create. So it is not just the environment that we create, but the building design, the building skin, the building the form, the shape, the material, all these aspects together should give comfort to the indoor environment. And that's the key focus of learning this subject in your architecture course. So learning all these basics put together, maybe in future semesters you will be applying these concepts into your designs to make your building thermally comfortable. So hence the knowledge of nature of comfort is essential in design with climate. So the nature of comfort, what is comfort, and how to define comfort, what are the factors that are required to define the comfort, is something that we will be checking up in detail in this. So we have an equation. I think even you would have covered this earlier. So you have body metabolism, evaporation, conduction, radiation. So metabolism, conduction, convection, radiation. So your metabolism is always adding heat. Your evaporation is always losing heat. That's why it's always plus here. It's always minus here. Which means if you are doing some activity, if you are dancing, walking, jumping, running, which is your metabolic activity, which keeps adding heat to your body. And if you are sweating and the sweat evaporates, you are losing heat in the form of evaporation. So that's why it is losing heat. Then conduction can be gaining or losing, radiation can be gaining or losing, and then convection can be gaining or losing. So they are all plus or minus. So everything should be added up to zero, and that's how we maintain our thermal balance in our body. So if the whole equation, if the whole heat loss and heat gain is more than zero, which means you are gaining more heat, then your skin temperature is high, your heat loss process to air is increased, your metabolic rate decreased, so you don't do much of activity because you're already gaining more heat and you have to lose heat, you don't do any activity. So body starts sweating. So body starts sweating because that's the best way to lose heat, and body does react that way. So when you sweat and the sweat gets evaporated, you lose heat. So when this is more than zero, you keep sweating, which means this is hotter. When it is less than zero, which means you are losing out heat. So you're feeling cold. So this is cold situation where your skin temperatures are lower, your heat loss process to the air is reduced, your metabolic rate increases. So when you feel colder, your metabolic rate increases. So if you are feeling colder, instead of sitting, if you just stand and walk, or if you keep jumping for some time, you might feel better because you are generating heat to balance out the heat loss that is happening because of the coldness, and body starts shivering. So when you don't do any activity, and if your body still feels that you have to generate some heat to balance out the heat loss because of the cold, so you will start shivering, and that's how you maintain your thermal balance in the body. So what are the different factors that affect the thermal comfort? So this is the major important point that we have to remember, because this is what we are trying to address. These are the six factors which we are discussing here, are what we are trying to address by making a better building which is climatic responsive. A climate responsive building meets all these six parameters to certain extent to make ourselves comfortable. So of course there is clothing here which might not be directly related with building, and metabolic rate which might not be directly related with building. These are of more of human intervention, human behavior, but the other four can be still dependent on the building design. So let's see what are they. So we know temperature very clearly. Everybody knows that, you know, if temperature is hot, if the temperature is high, we feel hotter. If the temperature is low, we feel colder. But we need to understand it is not just temperature. It is by just knowing temperature, we cannot say whether we are comfortable or not. Sometimes the temperature, if I say temperature at 24 degrees, it's not very easy to say whether I am comfortable or not. Sometimes I might be comfortable even at 30 degrees. Sometimes I might not be comfortable at 25 degrees. Generally 24 plus or minus 2, which is 22 to 26 degrees, is considered as comfortable temperature. But still at 25 degrees or 26 degrees, if the humidity is very high, so we are bringing in the in another element of the climatic parameters, which is humidity. So humidity also has certain impact on the comfort feelings. So for somebody who is from the coastal regions like Mangalore or Cochin, you will definitely feel suffocating, or if you feel super hot even at 30 degrees centigrade because of very high humidity. If the humidity is lesser, for example, if you take places like Mangalore, Mysore or Bangalore, you see that you know, the temperatures are 30 degrees, the humidity is very not very high as much as coastal regions. So lesser humidity, even at higher temperature, we feel a bit better. So these are the humidity is another parameter we need to understand to say whether we are at comfortable conditions or not. So once we know air temperature and humidity, this is not enough to say that, you know, we are meeting thermal comfort. There is another factor which is called air speed. So for example, if I'm sitting at certain temperature, 30, 32 degrees centigrade, and the humidity is pretty high, first thing what we do to feel ourselves comfortable is to switch on the fan and sit in front of fan, or go to the terrace, or go somewhere where you get air breeze that happens. So what happens there is, when you're feeling very hotter, when the air movement happens, you feel comfortable because air is taking away some heat through convection. If the air speed is high, you feel more comfortable because you lose more heat and you feel more comfortable. So these are three major parameters which we need to understand. Then the fourth one is radiant temperature. We'll discuss about this in the upcoming slides, exactly what does it mean. Then these are the four parameters which I would say which are more linked with the building design. When it comes to human interventions, these two are more important. So if the even if you are feeling even if you're sitting in an air conditioned room, the room is completely conditioned, maintained at a good comfortable temperature of 24 degrees centigrade or 22. Some of you might even put your remote you know, temperature settings to 18 degrees, 19 degrees. But if you are dancing in that room, for example, or doing some exercise in that room, for example, you take an example of gym where we keep exercising, even if the temperatures are maintained at 18 degrees, 19, 20 degrees, it's completely conditioned space, even then people feel hot because of the metabolic activity that they do. So when you do higher metabolic activities, you feel more hotter because you keep generating heat. And to lose the heat, you sweat automatically. And then clothing insulation. A simple example is if the room is air conditioned, if it is conditioned at 24 degrees centigrade, which is a decent condition temperature, and humidity is maintained very well, but still you might be sweating because you are wearing your jacket or whatever clothing, the thicker clothing. And sometimes if the temperature is maintained at 24, 22, same temperature, but if you are wearing very thin cotton clothes, you might feel a bit colder also. If you don't do any activity, and if you're just sitting calm, and if the air is still and the temperature is 22 and you are wearing very thin cloth, you might feel little colder because of the clothing, which is not sufficient to keep yourself at 24 degrees centigrade to feel more comfortable. So if it is, it depends, it's not just how your room is keeping you, it is also about the activity, it is also about your clothing that matters when you decide upon the thermal comfort of a person in a building or a person in general. So from here we'll get into the slight in-depth discussion again. You would have learnt what is temperature, how to measure temperature, what are the different ways of measuring, what are the different means of measuring temperature. But here we'll try to understand we'll revise it, and we'll try to understand how important is it in defining the thermal comfort. So dry bulb temperature, you all know that your normal thermometer, taken the reading that you take with a normal thermometer in your surrounding air. Of course, there are certain conditions which you would have studied earlier, that radiation should not be falling onto the thermometer, and it should have a closed structure where breeze is not affecting the reading. So with all those conditions, your normal room temperature is called dry bulb temperature. You have to remember So you have to remember this dry bulb temperature, which is called DBT, we keep referring it as DBT, is the normal temperature of the surrounding air, ambient temperature that we measure. So this is very important term that we need to remember. So when the dry bulb temperatures are low, people feel cold. When the temperatures are high, people feel hot. The unit of measurements, we all know degrees Celsius, and it is generally said comfortable between 16 to 28 degrees centigrade, which is not exactly 16 to 28. In some places, some people might feel 22 to 24 or 26 as comfortable temperature. Some of you might feel 20 to 30 degrees is comfortable temperature. So it depends from place to place, person to person. Conditions in winters, our feelings are different. In summers, our feelings are different. So if it is very hot summer at 40 degrees centigrade outside, even at 30 degrees inside, you will feel comfortable in a naturally ventilated building, in a normal open building where you are walking from outside at 40 degrees centigrade, you are reaching your home, you come inside. Your inside temperature, even if it is at 30 degrees centigrade, because you came from 40 degrees centigrade, you might still feel comfortable. So if you are sitting in an office and working for 8 hours continuously a day, so maybe maintaining it at certain range is very important to keep yourself comfortable. So this range is something that we are going to discuss in detail in this lecture and the coming lecture, which will tell us how to see the temperature along with other parameters to define what is temperature. So we'll see how the values are being taken. And here you would have come across this dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature. We'll try to discuss these two in detail, because these two are very important to understand the interrelation between dry bulb and wet bulb in link with humidity, which we'll be discussing in further slides. So here, as I told you, the dry bulb temperature is just the temperature that we measure directly of the surrounding air. So this is a direct measurement which we are having a thermometer, just keep it in the air and measuring the temperature. So wet bulb temperature, you see this is the apparatus here. This is the dry bulb temperature, which is just kept. This particular metal strip is given so that air movement is not affecting the actual air temperature at that place, and the radiation is not falling on the mercury bulb there, because radiation and this air movement will impact the dry bulb temperature reading. So we need just the air temperature at that particular location. So this is dry bulb temperature. So here the reading is about 31 degrees centigrade. So 31 degrees centigrade is the dry bulb temperature. Now let's see what is wet bulb temperature. In wet bulb temperature, we are going to cover the mercury bulb which is there with a wet cloth in a box, or just cover the whole wet bulb with a wet cloth. So the cloth which is wet with water, which has water content or moisture content. So what happens when we put a wet cloth in the air, when we dry our clothes, so after washing our clothes, when we put the cloths for drying, so once we put it out for drying, the air, the wetness, the moisture in the cloth will keep evaporating, right? So when water evaporates, as we discussed earlier, when the sweat evaporates, what happens? It takes heat and evaporate. So that's why we call it as evaporative cooling. So whenever there is evaporation, there is certain cooling that happens there. So now you can tell me, if the moisture content on the wet cloth keeps evaporating, when the moisture content is evaporating, what happens to the mercury bulb here? Since evaporation is taking out the heat away, so the mercury bulb will be much cooler compared to the dry bulb mercury bulb. So compared to the dry mercury bulb, this wet cloth covered mercury bulb will have a smaller reading. So you can see the reading here is not there at all. It is completely low. So for example, if the wet bulb temperature reading says about 10 degrees centigrade, for example, so there is certain heat that is going away. So from 31 degrees centigrade, there is certain heat that is going away. So the reading on the wet bulb temperature is 10 degrees centigrade. Now you might ask me, sir, why are we doing this? Why are we measuring this wet bulb and dry bulb, and what is the importance of it? What is the need of it? How does it affect with the surroundings or with current scenario which is happening around? So for example, here, if the temperature, we know the temperature is 31 degrees centigrade. Now if the surrounding air is covered with very high humidity, which means the air has lot of moisture in the air, or there is another case where it is very 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 dry. So when it is very dry, the evaporation that happens on this wet cloth will be very high. So when the evaporation is very high, which means when it is very dry, the evaporation is very high. When it is wet, the evaporation becomes very less. So when the evaporation is very high, which means the cooling effect is very high on the thermometer, on the mercury bulb, so the reading will be lower. So very high dry bulb temperature, very low wet bulb temperature means we have dry air around, which means lesser moisture. So when the moisture is lesser, when it is very dry, the evaporation is more. When the evaporation is more heat goes off, so the bulb is at lower temperature, so the reading comes down. If the moisture is very high and the surrounding air is wet, the evaporation is not that much as it is happening in the dry air. So when the evaporation is not happening, the temperature, the reading is not coming so much down, so it will be little higher. When this and wet bulb temperature are same, when the wet bulb temperature, when the dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature are at same level, which means this evaporation is not at all happening. When evaporation is not at all happening, this means that the whole air, surrounding air is filled up with moisture completely. The air is saturated with moisture completely. The air cannot take any more moisture, and that's why there is no evaporation happening. When no evaporation is happening, the dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature becomes same. So these are the few concepts why we are measuring dry bulb and wet bulb temperature, to understand the moisture content or humidity. And we'll see in the next slides how we see humidity, what are the different terminologies that we need to understand with humidity again. So you would have understood what is temperature before in the previous module, but in this module we are trying to understand the relation between the humidity and temperatures in a better way. And there is mean radiant temperature. We just saw wet bulb temperature, dry bulb temperature, but mean radiant temperature is actually the radiation from the surrounding bodies that is falling on you, that is radiating on you, is something we can see. The mean radiant is what we can say, the radiant temperature. When we say mean radiant temperature, this means that if you are sitting in a room, so you have a lot of objects, so your room is getting hotter and it is radiating heat, and you are radiating heat outside, and the floor is also taking heat or radiating heat. So there are a lot of elements in the room that are impacting your the radiation that is falling on you. So if we keep all these radiations happening in the room and take a mean of it and an average of it, as a single room which is giving single value of radiation that is happening from the room. It's an imaginary room which is having similar impact of all these impacts as one room impact. That's what we measure it as, mean radiant temperature. So the uniform temperature of an imaginary enclosure which the radiant heat transfer from the human body is equal to the radiant heat transfer in the actual non-uniform enclosure. So we have different non-uniform enclosure where there are so many things which are radiating heat and taking, we are radiating back the heat. When we equate it to a room which has uniform radiation, which is an average of all these radiations, that's why we call this as mean radiant temperature. So radiation exchange will depend on mean temperature of surrounding surfaces, referred to as mean radiant temperature. So you would have discussed in your previous module, again we measure this through globe temperature. So there is a globe thermometer, and you would have checked the apparatus and all those things in the previous module. So we need to understand the mean radiant temperature is very important because your building design has a big impact. The material we choose, the way we put windows, and the size of the room, the volume of the room, a lot of aspects has impact on this mean radiant temperature, which will have an impact on the user comfort, the user thermal comfort in the room. So that's why it's very important. We will discuss it in the module 3, where we will talk about how to calculate this heat gain happening from these different surfaces of the building. Okay, so mean radiant temperature is what is getting impacted by the building design, material selection, your surroundings, your envelope and everything. So air temperature and mean radiant temperature. So here air temperature is the temperature that we measure at your point, but mean radiant temperature, if the object which is radiating heat is nearer to you, it radiates more heat onto you. If it is further, the overall radiant temperature that is impacting you, it will be very less. So it depends on the distance of the object and the size of the object that matters, based on which the mean radiant temperature is getting impacted. Now coming to humidity, we have discussed earlier about humidity. We need to understand that there are two terminologies we need to understand, that one is absolute humidity, and in the next slides we will discuss relative humidity. So whatever we see in the weather channels, whenever you check about your weather of your place, what is today's weather, we check, right? So when we check our weather for that particular day or particular time, we will get the humidity in the values of 50% or 100% or 70. So if it is very hot, humid place like Mangalore, Goa, Cochin, Chennai, which are coastal areas where the humidity is comparably higher, you will find the humidity in the range of 90% RH, we say. So RH stands for relative humidity. And so we need to understand, whatever we see in our weather data, weather information, that we, whenever we check any weather information, what we see is relative humidity, not absolute humidity. So what is absolute humidity? Absolute humidity is exactly what is the amount of humidity that is present in a given volume of it. So here in this case, 15 milligrams of humidity is there in 1 liter or X amount of liters. So 15 milligrams per 1 liter is what is absolute humidity. So if I fill the whole bottle with 30 milligrams of moisture, then it is called 30 milligrams per 1 liter of the volume of the space of the air. So 1 liter of air has 30 milligrams of moisture. So we are exactly measuring what is this, what is the amount of moisture in a given volume. So we have absolute humidity units as milligrams per liter. So this is absolute humidity. We are checking exactly what is the actual amount of moisture in a given volume of the air. Is what we call as absolute humidity. Now let us understand what is relative humidity. So we know this is absolute humidity to see what is the exact amount of water in a given space. Now let's say, just consider this particular situation where we have 15 milligrams per liter. So we are, for example, this is a closed container and we are adding heat to this. So when we are adding heat, what happens? Air expands, your moisture also expands, what happens is when the temperature rises, when the temperature is rising, your moisture holding capacity, the maximum holding capacity of the air, changes. In fact, when the temperature is raised, the moisture holding capacity decreases. So there is a certain table which can be found in our Koenigsberger book also. You can check it up in the Koenigsberger book in the last pages in appendices, you will find this. So you see this moisture content grams per kilogram of air is varying varying from at different temperatures. So 0 degrees, there is, for example, we'll let's say 24 degrees, let's say 35 degrees. So you see the moisture content, the density of air, and the moisture content here grams per kilogram, here grams per volume meter cube. So let's say for 1 meter cube, air can hold 4.8 grams per one. So if I take 1 meter cube, 1 meter by 1 meter by 1 meter cube of volume of air, we will find 4.887 amount grams of moisture. That is the amount of moisture that it can hold. So why this is called a saturation point humidities. So there is absolute humidity. What is exactly amount of moisture that is there in that given volume. This is something which we are discussing here is called saturation humidity. Saturation humidity is at a given temperature, if I keep adding humidity, after certain amount of absolute humidity, the saturation the air becomes saturated and it cannot take any more moisture. So that maximum capacity of that particular air at that particular temperature is called saturation humidity. So if I say at 0 degrees centigrade, in 1 meter cube of a container, if this is 1 meter cube container, in 1 meter cube container I can add only 4.887 grams of moisture. So at 0 degrees centigrade, it cannot take any more moisture. So at 35 degrees centigrade, it can take 41 grams of moisture. So if the temperature is rising, when the temperature rises, the amount of moisture the air can hold will be very high. So 41, you see 4.8 and 41, almost 10 times of more moisture that air can hold. So this is called saturation humidity. Now if you understand in a given place, if it is very cold in the nights, very in the winter season especially, if it is very very cold in the night, what happens is if the air has x amount of for example absolute humidity of the air at night 8 p.m. in the night time before you sleep, when you measure the absolute humidity, for example it is 30 grams per meter cube. So 1 meter cube of volume of air I took and I measured the weight of the moisture, and the moisture is about 30 grams in that air. Now what happens in the night time when it is very 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 cold and the temperature is falling to 10 degrees for example. At 10 degrees the air can hold only 9.5 grams. Now what happens to this extra 20 grams that the air cannot hold at that temperature? Will be falling down in the form of dew, which you generally find in the mornings, and that's why the soils are very wet in the cold seasons, in the winter seasons. The early mornings you find lot of moisture content which is seen as a in the form of the dew, and in the daytime slowly when the sun comes and the heat is being generated by the sun onto the earth's surface, your temperature keeps rising and your air can hold more and more temperature, and this water drops or water content on the earth's surface will start evaporating and will be held by the air again. So we need to understand that the saturation humidity is different for different temperatures. So we need to remember this point that the saturation humidity changes is different for different temperatures. Now what is relative humidity? Let's say relative humidity is nothing but your absolute humidity. What is your percentage of moisture that is present in the air when compared to the overall holding capacity of the air? Now for example, if at in percentage, So this is for a given temperature. We need to mention that given temperature it happens. For example, if I say at 40 degrees centigrade, we have seen that it is 41 grams that it can hold. And if I have 41 grams added into the air completely, so 41 by 41 gives me 100% RH. So in case if the air has only 10 grams of humidity, which means around 25% RH, because it is only 10 grams out of 41 grams, which is almost equal to 25% RH. So in a dry place, when I say if it is a dry place, we cannot say the amount of moisture is less or moisture is high. We always say in terms of relative humidity, which is nothing but your total holding capacity, which is saturation humidity, and your actual moisture, which is absolute humidity. The ratio of these two is what we see as relative humidity. Now, why this relative humidity has been invented and how it is impacted, and these things we will discuss in the further slides and in the next presentation also. So you must have to remember that relative humidity and is the percentage of the humidity out of the total holding capacity, which is called saturation humidity at a given temperature. So it's a ratio of actual amount of moisture present to the amount of moisture of air that air can hold at a given temperature. So if the temperature is changing, your RH will change. So for example, if it is at 40 degrees centigrade, I have 10 grams, my RH is 25%, we have calculated. So 40 degrees centigrade, 10 grams, RH is 25%. So same thing, if I say 10 degrees centigrade, 10 grams, we have checked in the previous slide that we have around 9.5, so which is, if I say almost 10, so RH will be 10 grams absolute humidity by holding capacity at 10 degrees centigrade, is which is saturation humidity, which is 10 grams. So this gives 10 by 10, which is 100% RH. So what we need to understand here is the absolute humidity is same 10 grams at 40 degrees and same 10 grams at 10 degrees. So absolute humidity is same, right? And the saturation humidity is varying from this scenario to this scenario because of change in temperature. So when the holding capacity at 40 is very high, so 10 grams is only 25% at 40 degrees centigrade, that is our RH. So your RH will be 100% for the same amount of moisture in the air. You are not changing the moisture in the air, but you are changing the temperature. When you change the temperature, same moisture content in the same volume becomes different RH, because your holding capacity of the air becomes different. So how is this so important? As I told you, we will discuss in the further slides. It has very direct relation with your dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature. So your wet bulb temperature is same with the dry bulb temperature when both are same, when there is no evaporation happening. Now this no evaporation happening is a scenario which happens only if the air reaches its holding capacity, which is again dependent on dry bulb temperature. So dry bulb because of the dry bulb temperature, based on the amount of temperature, the normal air temperature, your evaporation is varying. When your evaporation, your saturation temperature, saturation humidity is varying. Because saturation humidity is varying, your evaporation varies, and if your evaporation is varying, your wet bulb temperature reading varies. So this is something that the relation that we will discuss, and based on which we feel comfortable or not, is something we can see in the further slides. So relative humidity 100% RH, which means completely water vapor, completely the whole volume has water vapor. So if the whole volume has only water vapor, to 50% of the air has water vapor at 20 degrees centigrade. So same amount of water vapor at 10 degrees centigrade, my holding capacity is this much, so it is 100% RH. Same amount of water vapor but my holding capacity of the air, this much water can be held by this much air, where RH will be only 53%. So if I'm increasing the temperature, the holding capacity can be increased, of which this whole water vapor is only 28%. So it is always about the holding capacity that we need. So in the bottom one, you can see the moisture is 100%, RH is 100%. When your moisture is 50%, RH is still 100% because of the holding capacity of that particular temperature. So it is all about the temperature that impacts, apart from the the amount of water vapor that you have. So if, for example, in this case it is 53% RH, where the water content is this much. If I add more water into this, more moisture content into this, so for example, if I add so much, it might go up to 60 or 70% at this temperature. So we have to always mention RH is so and so at that particular temperature. So when the temperature changes with the same moisture, the RH will vary. So when there is low humidity, which means RH is lesser, the air is very dry, which means your holding capacity of the air is this much, and your RH is low, which means the air amount of moisture content of with respect to its saturation humidity levels is very less, which means the air is very dry, and sweating is more effective in cooling down the body. So your sweating can be happening if the holding capacity of the air is high, and if your RH is very less, so your air still has capacity to take more moisture. So it helps us to take our sweat and evaporate our sweat, and that's how we can cool our body. So in a dry place, your sweating can help us in cooling our body. So when there is high humidity, like places like the coastal areas which we discussed about, Mangalore or Goa or Cochin, Chennai, so when you go there, your air is already saturated with the moisture to very high levels. So if the holding capacity of the air is this much, it is the moisture content is already this much, so there is very less scope for us to have evaporation happening. So that is why sweating is not a very effective in cooling down the body wherever there is high humidity. So thermal comfort can be achieved at the humidity with the ranges of 30 to 50 degree 50%. So generally 50%, which is neither too dry nor too humid, is considered to be a comfortable humidity levels. So when we say dry bulb and wet bulb temperature, this is a question based on our previous slides discussion. So when there is a reading of wet bulb temperature and dry bulb temperature which reads same, for example, this is at 25 degrees centigrade, your wet bulb is also reading 25, your dry bulb is also reading 25 degrees centigrade, which means what is the RH, relative humidity, what is the levels of what is the percentage of relative humidity from this particular. So you can take a pause, calculate it, and then get back so that we'll discuss the answer for this one. So if you had come back from your break, and if you have an answer, the answer is 100% RH. So let us see why it is 100%. Because the dry bulb and wet bulb are same, which means no evaporation has happened. When does no evaporation happens? Whenever the air is already saturated completely, which is 100% saturated, right? So when the air is completely saturated, which means absolute humidity is equal to saturation humidity. So air absolute humidity is already nearing your saturation humidity, so there is no scope for any further evaporation to happen, and that is the reason why the evaporation is not happening at all. So when the evaporation doesn't happen at all, the mercury reading will be same, because there is no heat that is being lost because of evaporation. So the reading of the mercury will be same as the dry bulb temperature, so which is 25 degrees centigrade here. So at 25 degrees centigrade, when we say RH is 100%, so we can understand from the air properties which we have seen earlier, at 25 degrees centigrade, the capacity of the air is 23 grams per meter cube. This is the absolute humidity of the air. So if you want to check the moisture content per grams per kg, it is 20 grams per kilogram. Is something is something the absolute humidity will be. So absolute humidity is 20 grams per kilogram, which is equal to relative humidity at 25 degrees centigrade, which is what we have checked as a reading here. So let's check another simple question. Now there is case A, this is in some city A, and this is in another city B. So there are two cities we have taken a reading at a given point of time, where both the cities has dry bulb temperature same, let's say 25 degrees again here. So but when we in both the cities, though the dry bulb temperature is same, right, but the wet bulb temperature is the reading in the wet bulb temperature reading is different, where in city B the wet bulb temperature is very high compared to city A. Now the question is, which of these two cities is a dry place? Right. You can take a break, you can pause the video and check out for the answer, and we can discuss again. So if you have checked and come back with your answer, let us understand what is happening here. Why is this low here? The reason when the wet bulb temperature is lower, this means more heat is being losing out from this place through evaporation. So evaporation is high, that is why the temperature reading is lower. So when the evaporation is high, which means the air is not that saturated, it can still take more moisture, and that is why evaporation is happening. When the air is not saturated, which means this has lesser moisture compared to this one, where it didn't evaporate as much as this city does. Here evaporation is not happening so much, so the temperature reading in the wet bulb temperature is little bit higher. So wet bulb temperature is higher compared to this one. So if, say for example, if this is 25, if this is reading is 20 and this is 15 degrees centigrade, so this means the wet bulb temperature reading, it doesn't mean that your temperature is actually 15 degrees centigrade. It is only the wet bulb temperature reading which is measured to calculate or understand the moisture content, to understand the relative humidity. So when we know that the wet bulb temperature is lower and the dry bulb temperature is higher, when the gap is more, when it happens only when the evaporation is happening. So understand that when the evaporation is happening more, which means the air has more scope for us to to take more moisture into the air, which means the place is a bit comparably drier compared to city B. So here's case A is more drier city compared to case B. So coming to air velocity, we all have discussed already, we all have checked, we all have understood that air velocity is important. Sometimes when we feel suffocated, when we feel sweat, when we are sweating and the sweat is not getting evaporated, maybe because of high saturated moisture in the air and the sweat is not getting evaporated, we need to sit in front of a fan to feel ourselves comfortable. So we need a certain speed of the air. So when the air velocity up to only 1.1 meter per second, we may feel that stuffiness in the indoors, where there is no air, the air is suffocating, we call it. So we call it as suffocating. So this air speed should be a bit higher, so for it to be comfortable. So up to 0.1 to 1 meter per second is the speed that we can see as comfortable movement. And again, it is not that always you should have air movement. For example, if you are already in a very comfortable temperature, humidity is 50% relative humidity, which is average humidity, comfortable humidity, and the temperature is at 24 degrees centigrade, you might not need air velocity to happen for you to feel comfortable. Except for that, you need some fresh air for your better oxygen breathing. So you can't sit in a room without any ventilation, where no outside air is coming, no inside air is going out. Then the oxygen levels might fall down after a certain period of time, a longer exposure in that room. So in such situations, maybe air movement, this thing might make you feel comfortable. if the already the your humidity and temperature are already at comfortable levels, maybe air velocity might not have an impact. But if these two are varying, air velocity might have a big impact in the way you feel comfortable. An example which we have discussed already, in coastal areas where the humidity is already very high, you feel very comfortable when you stand against a breeze or you stand in front of a fan. So here, simple example, at 30 degrees drywall temperature, which is a typical temperatures of mornings or evenings in coastal areas, we can say, and 25 degrees wet bulb temperature. We know that when drywall is higher and wet bulb is not same and lower, which means it has certain amount of humidity, which give an effective temperature. We'll discuss this effective temperature in this presentation. The end, you would have discussed in your module 1 also. So after 27, this gives a 27 degrees centigrade with still air less than 0.1 meter. So here the upper comfort limit at 40% RH is 30 degrees centigrade. So these figures are not given, but it is similar to this. So the upper comfort limit at 40% RH is 30 degrees centigrade with still air, but 36 at 1 meter per second, which means 40% RH is comfort limit, your upper comfort limit. 40% at 40% RH, 30 degrees centigrade is your upper comfort limit at still air. So when air movement is not there, your comfort is at 30 degrees centigrade with 40% RH because of these two scenarios. But at 36 degrees centigrade with 1 meter per second air. So when the air movement is included, when the air movement is induced, you still feel comfortable at 36 degrees centigrade. So for this given condition, when your comfort is only 30 degrees centigrade, but which means when the air is not moving at 31, 32 degrees centigrade, you feel suffocated, you feel still hotter. But if you induce air movement, your comfort level, you can even feel comfortable at 36 degrees centigrade. So air movement defines your comfort situation also. A person who is not feeling comfortable at the same temperature, if you add air, generally when you are feeling hotter, when the temperature is high, for you to feel comfortable, you should reduce the temperature. You should switch on a air conditioning system which takes out the heat, or you induce a fan. You switch on the fan, it can, air velocity will take out some heat and makes you feel comfortable at the same air temperature around you. So same, in general, in this problem, when a person is feeling comfortable at 30 degrees centigrade at still air, this is the maximum limit. So which means at 31 degrees centigrade, it is hotter for him. But if I add air at 1 meter per second velocity, my comfort level can reach up to 36 degrees centigrade, where I can feel comfortable up to 36 degrees centigrade. So when it comes to clothing, we all know there is it's a known fact that we keep changing our clothing based on seasons. We wear sweaters in winters, we wear cotton clothes in summers. So there is certain clothing is one of the dominant factors affecting heat dissipation for purposes of comfort studies. They have created this unit called CLO. So 0.5 clothing, less than 0.5 clothing is a kind of not fully covered or very light cotton clothing, where if it is more than 3.5, it is woolen clothing, very fully closed and stuffed up clothing kind of thing. So there are different ranges in that, and based on the different ranges, your comfort levels also varies from season to season based on the other parameters which we are discussing. So there are different clothing material and their respective clothing values that has been given in this table. So it also impacts our comfort levels. Metabolic rate, we understood that you do some activity, it generates certain heat and you feel more hot or lesser. So metabolic rate is measured in watt per meter square. So this is per area. So MET is the value, metabolic rate value. So what is the metabolic rate for sleeping is 0.7, which means your body is emitting about 40 watts. So if you compare it with the power that is consumed for a light bulb or something like that, so your body can produce that much of heat, that much of energy, watts per meter, meter square of surface area. So there is so if you are not doing anything, if you are sitting and resting, then it is 58 watts, which is what we call as metabolic rate 1. So this is a benchmark of 1. So when we say, when somebody says what is metabolic rate of 1 means, which means we are emitting total of about 100 watts on an average, 58 watts per meter square roughly. So this is one unit of metabolic rate that we can call when a person is not doing any activity, right? So this is a benchmark. So if you are sitting, that is one metabolic rate. If you are sleeping, you means you are not producing any energy, any not as much as heat that you produce when you are sitting. So based on which, again, if you are standing, it will increase, and if you are doing very heavy work, furnace work or squash or something, then it is 7. So if you are doing you know, social dancing, then it is 3. So it depends. If you do very heavy activity, your metabolic rate increases, and amount of heat that you generate is also increased per meter square. So it's meter square here. So what we need to understand here is, you can see here, some person is checking the temperature, some person is sitting with the fan, somebody is feeling very, very cold here. So somebody is very feeling very cold, somebody is feeling very hot, who is putting a fan and you know, taking sipping a cold coffee or something. So each person has a different metabolic rate, and each person has a different perception of thermal comfort. That is something that we need to understand. So we have understood all the 6 factors, which has different readings and different parameters, which has different impacts, and all these 6 factors together gives us the feeling of comfort, whether we are comfortable or not. And most of these are interrelated, as we have discussed that temperature with dry bulb, wet bulb, and air velocity and humidity, these are all interrelated. And even if you have everything comfortable, if your clothing is different, you might not feel comfortable. So all these 6 are important to understand the thermal comfort of a human body. And we'll quickly go through these thermal comfort indices. You would have covered this in your module 1 from our other instructor. So just quickly, I'll quickly recap this one. So we need these thermal comfort indices to understand the scale which impacts the combined effect of all these factors which we have discussed, is called a thermal index or a comfort scale. So how, like for example, in a simple words, if a person is feeling comfortable or not, I can't say at 24 degrees centigrade at 50% RH a person is comfortable. So what happens if it is at 25 degrees centigrade? What happens if it is at 40 RH? So we need to understand a range of scale that is prepared which has combined effects of all these parameters which we have discussed earlier, because we know they are all completely interlinked. If one is varying, the other is also varying. So this is what we call as a thermal index or comfort scale, and these are the indices which are developed by different people through different studies. So there are different types of comfort indexes. One is international model, one is Indian model, based on geography. Based on variables, variables is what we have discussed earlier, all this. So heat balance comfort model and adaptive comfort model. So when I say heat balance comfort model, how like what is the exact value of the temperature, this, and you are sitting in certain situation, and what is the value at which you are comfortable, is something general heat balance comfort model. Adaptive comfort model is something like this. For example, you are from a very hot place. Say for example Mangalore, you had moved to Bangalore, which is pretty colder compared to Mangalore. So the when you come to from Mangalore to Bangalore, when the day you have moved, you feel it is very, very cold in Bangalore. But after living for certain time, you might feel that Bangalore is normal, and you get adjusted to it and you get adapted to that. So here adaptive thermal comfort model does talk about, it's not just 24 degrees centigrade exactly my body might feel comfortable. For example, I am a person who lives in a hotter place. My body has got adjusted to 35 degrees, 36 degrees temperatures. For me, for my body, for that particular condition where the temperatures are 36 degrees centigrade outside in general, for my body at that particular place, I might be comfortable even at 29 degrees centigrade. So heat balance comfort models talks about exact situation at which human body feels comfortable, but based on the outdoor conditions, if we consider the outdoor situations into factor and say, and there your body gets adapted to certain other temperatures, and that is what we call as adaptive comfort models they have created. So thermal comfort in mechanically ventilated buildings, generally this heat balance comfort model comes into picture. In naturally ventilated buildings, generally we talk about adaptive thermal comfort models. So in other words, the adaptive thermal comfort is based on the idea of outdoor climatic influences. Outdoor climate influences the indoor climate because humans can adapt to different temperatures. As I have discussed, if your outdoor temperature is 35 degrees centigrade always, and your body is adjusted to that, maybe your 27 degrees or 28 degrees is comfortable for you. But if your outdoor temperature is always lesser, for example, if it is a very cold place like Ooty or Shimla, where your temperatures are 18 degrees centigrade mostly, for just for an example, not exactly that's how it is, for them 27 degrees might be hotter. So for a hot place, 27 degrees is comfortable, but for a cold place, 27 might be a bit hotter compared to their normal temperatures. So it depends on the place to place and location. So where outdoor climatic condition has certain influence on the way we feel in the indoors, and that's what adaptive thermal comfort talks about. So we have physiological and psychological. So some are psychological feelings, some are physiological. Physiological is your body activity, your body physical behavior of your body is physiological, and behavioral. Behavioral is nothing but for example, you take an AC remote and say that I'll put it at 18 degrees centigrade. So it's a behavioral comfort that you feel comfortable at 18 degrees centigrade. Or your activities might have an impact on physiological. And psychological is that when you say that you are going to Ooty and you feel a cold place, you know that you are going to a cold place, and you are psychologically thinking that, you know, it's a very cold place and this is the temperatures I might feel comfortable, kind of thinking that comes. So all these have different impacts and different ways a person perceives or person thinks about their comfort levels. So why adaptive thermal comfort model? A much broader temperature range is considered comfortable by users for free running buildings. They can adapt to varying boundaries. So for example, if I say normal thermal comfort model, I should say 24 plus or minus 2. But adaptive thermal comfort model can increase this to 24 plus or minus 4 degrees centigrade, for example. Let's say if I say I am not comfortable after 26 degrees centigrade is an absolute way of saying it. But if a person can feel comfortable at up to 30 degrees centigrade because he has never seen air conditioning, for example, he has been living in hotter place, and for him 30 degrees is also comfortable. So if he is comfortable at 30 degrees centigrade, we might not go for air conditioning systems. So hence the dependence of the mechanical systems are much reduced, and the room for passive design strategies is created. So if your passive design is giving him comfortable, you don't need much of air conditioning systems and other heating systems or something for you to feel comfortable, because you are comfortable at a larger range of temperatures and humidity and other aspects. So we understood that we need certain indices, certain range of temperatures, range of humidity at which we feel comfortable is something that we have understood, and there are different ways of thermal indices that we have understood. In your previous module from other instructor, you would have covered all different types of these indices. There are majorly we need to understand the effective temperature and corrected effective temperature. I will just cover this one again in the next lecture very detailedly, what is effective temperature and how to read it and see it. Again, you would have checked it again in the previous module, but this is important for us to understand your next module, next lecture. So these are different way indices again. So bioclimatic chart you would have studied in your previous module. Then ASHRAE comfort model we will discuss again in the next one, And tropical summer index, which is created by CBRA, this also would have been discussed in your previous module. So these are the few things, and there is this psychrometric chart, which is very important for us to understand how to plot all these features which we have studied and see what is comfort zone, what is not comfort zone. In the next lecture, we will discuss about these aspects in detail. And we will also try to see the psychrometric chart, the psychrometric chart plotted for different cities like Bangalore, Mangalore, Belgaum, and some other climatic zones of India. We will see how much time of a given year we are comfortable, how much time we are not comfortable, how to define that comfort zone, and how does it vary, and how to interpret that, whether we have hot times and cold times. Like for example, if you take Mangalore for example, it's very hot in summer afternoons because of high humidity on high temperatures also. But if you come to evenings of winter, it will be comparably comfortable in Mangalore. Winter evenings, because the temperatures are also lower, though the humidity is higher, your temperatures are not that high that you feel super uncomfortable. You might be in the comfort zone. Also, because of when I say evenings, the temperatures are already falling down, and a certain kind of breeze that comes into picture or whatever. So different times of a year, different days, different months, different seasons has different ways of your feelings, and this is something that leads us to understand comfort periods, the overheating periods, overcool periods. So we will try to see how it is changing from place to place, and how a different place has to be designed or seen, a building in that particular place has to be seen or designed based on these particular parameters, is something that we will see in our next lecture. So that's all for this lecture. Thank you for being with me in this lecture. We will continue with the next lecture with all these indices to be seen through psychrometric chart. And we will try to calculate the overheated periods based on the temperatures in the next lecture. Thank you. See you again in the next lecture.